Never had a lot, this is all I need. People never care till it's RIP. Just turn their back on me for no good reason. Loyalty is priceless and it's all I need. Can't burn a bridge just to light my way.
What's up? I'm Sydney Neely and I'm here with professional basketball player, sickle cell advocate, the author of the brand new book, Ode to the Warrior, and the first NBA player to play in the league with sickle cell, Billy Garrett. So Billy, tell us about Ode to the Warrior, the origins of it, and your vision for it in the future.
Ode to the Warrior fit the energy that the book was given. Just ode, literally meaning like respect to a warrior. People that have sickle cell refer to each other as sickle cell warriors. So I think it was just a great play on words there. Once the book got out, I was proud of the fact that it was versatile in that it told the story from the perspective of myself, like a person with sickle cell, being able to play professional basketball in the NBA all over the world, despite having the disease. But like me explaining that journey and like those nuggets that I picked up, the metaphysical lessons that I learned over the journey, are, you know, very relatable to everybody. So it's like very applicable to any walk of life. So I want Ode as a collective to kind of represent that same versatility, always rooted in like sickle cell outreach and awareness, but at the same time, very versatile, especially in the content that it produces, clothing, things like that. And more importantly, I want to like create community, like a space where I can easily reach supporters and supporters can easily reach me, especially, you know, people that have sickle cell and live that life. I want to be somebody that can connect to them. And also just fighters in general, man. I want to build a brand around that. So that's kind of how it originated with the book, but then, you know, it'll grow into so much more. And we'll see where it goes.
For someone who doesn't fully understand sickle cell, tell us about the disease and how it affects the body.
So sickle cell itself, to give you like a short version of it, it's an inherited blood disorder where your blood cell, your red blood cells aren't all the perfect circular shape and they don't pass as easily through your blood vessels. So when you have sickle cell, a lot of those red blood cells are shaped like sickles, like a C, kind of can be rigid, latch onto each other and like block blood flow through to your major organs and parts of your body. So when that happens, you'll have like extreme pain. And then on top of that, like your blood isn't carrying as much oxygen, which is like kind of the wonder behind playing sports with the disease, because like you're moving with like a oxygen deficiency on paper, right? So like that's kind of the way that works. And then on top of that, there's just a stigma around the disease. And stigma in the sense that it's one of the greatest health and racial disparities in modern medicine. I remember when I was putting a book out and letting people know that it was coming out, I was getting a great response from everyone. And a lady by the name of Maya Bloomberg, she's she's been like supporting me on social media for the past couple of years. I think she's a nurse practitioner. I'm not sure where she's from, but just know her through that. She commented and said, thank you for shedding light on the greatest health and racial disparity in modern medicine. And it kind of put it all into perspective for me, the stigma surrounding the disease. You know, sickle cell is a very, very serious thing in that sense of what it does to your body. So, you know, we're trying to shed a little bit of light on that.
I got to ask, what inspired you to write Ode to the Warrior? And tell us the story about how it came to be.
Yeah, so honestly, it started as something I was doing for myself, like a means of meditation in a sense. And then it came together. And like chronologically, it came together in a book format, even though I wasn't necessarily meaning to do that from the jump. I'm a heavy reader, so like naturally I like to write and do things like that just to kind of get my thoughts down on paper. And like a lot of support from the sickle cell community caused me to write it as well, just cause like through, you know, people seeing what I do for a living, playing sports with the disease, I get a lot of support. So it kind of gave me the motivation, if you will, to put the story out. You know what I mean? So yeah, that's kind of where it started. And then over time, it came together, got it to a publisher, and you know, they liked it and you know, enjoyed the story in itself and just kind of what the book represents. And that's how we're here now.
It's no secret that writing a book about your entire life story can get pretty personal. So did working on this project affect you on a deeper level, especially since it's tied to your own personal health journey?
Yeah. You know, I thought that going into it, like that it would be something that's really personal and be tough for me to get out. But it wasn't that difficult, to be honest with you, just because it's authentic. So, like, it's real. And I don't have a problem, like, sharing that and being transparent with other people, especially people that are dealing with what I'm dealing with, right? Like, end of the day, like, I've been blessed enough to, like, walk a path that has allowed me to play in the NBA, play professional basketball all over the world, and do it despite having a blood disorder and, you know, it being common knowledge that that's, like, out of the question, right? So being able to do that, like, it's kind of, I feel like, somewhat of a responsibility to share that process. You know what I mean? So in that, it wasn't hard for me to really share the journey because, like, I ain't ashamed of it. You know what I'm saying? Like, I don't mind letting people know about that. I was quiet about it for a long time just because, like, immaturity-wise, like, the basketball side of it, I ain't really wanted to hinder my career in a sense. But over time, you know, you start to realize that, you know, it's greater purpose. You know what I mean? And on top of that, it's just like an offering. You know, it's not like it's not medical advice. It's not a way to do this or do that. Like, it's just my experience. It's kind of an offering to God for real. Like, it's like I've been able to do this. So let me, like, offer that process back to somebody that's dealing with the same thing. Like me and taking that game that I picked up and running with it and not sharing it. That's super selfish in my opinion. You know what I mean? So, like, it wasn't hard to answer your question. It's no different from, like, you being a reporter. Like, young black girl, she wants to become a reporter and looks up to you. Like, you kind of got a duty to share the game. You know what I mean? So, like, that's kind of where it started. And that's why it's been easy for me to, like, make it through this process.
So you've played all over the world. As the first NBA player to play with sickle cell, what challenges, if any, did you face? And how did that shape your journey, both on and off the court?
Yeah. Early, especially in my college career, it was tough because doctors were, like, hesitant to let me play. Just because from a liability standpoint, you hadn't really seen this in high major basketball. So we had to work through that. That was a challenge in itself. And then just the challenge of competing and being able to compete with my teammates and, you know, wanting to not look any different from them, knowing that I was dealing with a health condition that kind of altered the way I had to prepare, essentially. So from a pride standpoint, that was hard for me as a kid, just because, you know, you want to be able to do everything that your teammates are doing, especially when you're trying to lead a team. And I talk about that a lot in the book, how I had to kind of figure that side of it out. But, you know, at the same time, it sharpened me as a competitor. Made me extremely disciplined, just because in order to be able to do what I love to do, I had to, you know, go the extra mile in order to get in the position that my body needed to be in. So it was tough early, but, I mean, it did more good than bad, and, like, it made me a super competitor, and it kind of made me a better basketball player in a sense. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. All right, you know, sickle cell can be pretty complicated, and not mm-hmm. everyone gets it. How does your book plan to help people understand more about this disease?
Yeah, I think it'll do a great job in spreading awareness, just because it'll spark the conversation. You know, it'll be something that you see, and someone who didn't know what sickle cell was before that now might be aware of it. And that's a victory in itself. But at the same time, it's more so for the sickle cell community in that aspect, because it's more about empowering people to have it versus letting people know what it is and aren't aware. Like, I want to do that as well, but I want the person that has sickle cell, you know, the kid that's dealing with it and has only been getting the perspective of his doctor, which is usually, and rightfully so, it's a very limited perspective in a sense of, like, what you can do in life. So I wanted to be able to kind of empower a kid where he could pick it up, look at it, read it, and be like, wait, he did what with? Oh yeah, I know I could. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's the kind of the that's kind of the impact that I wanted to have. So it was more based on empowering, more so than like spreading the message to somebody who doesn't know what it is anyways. Mm-hmm.
And how do you see your book, Ode to the Warriors, changing the conversation around sports and sickle cell?
Yeah, it's a good question. You know, I think of it kind of like the 4-minute mile, and I'll explain it. But like back in the, don't quote me on this time stamp, but like back in like the 30s, I think like nobody had ever seen somebody run a mile in under 4 minutes, right? So like, just naturally, like the human psyche was like, I can't be done. Like, it's not possible. It's not humanly possible. So in being the first to do something, I think you kind of have a responsibility to share the story so it can have that effect on sickle cell. So similar to what I just was referring to, like somebody reading it. And it doesn't even have to be basketball in a sense. But somebody reading a book, understanding what sickle cell is, having sickle cell themselves, even if it's parents, like you'll be like, wait a second. Like this whole time, I was looking at it from the perspective of it's a death sentence in terms of playing sports, right? And I got to live like this certain way. So, and seeing that story and being able to connect with the story that Ode to the Warrior tells, I wanted to have that 4-minute mile effect in where I don't want to be the last person to play, you know, high level sports that has the disease. Like, I want to see more and more and more people do that. And I think a way to kind of helping that cause is to share the story just so in your mind you know that it's possible. Like, I ain't really no different from anybody, you know what I mean? It's just my parents did a great job of I don't want to give away too much of the book, I'll talk about this in there as well, but they did a great job of like coaching me in a sense and teaching me to look at the disease from a glass half full vantage point, you know what I mean? Like, what I can do, try it, see how it goes, and then you just continue to build and you get to, you know, where you want to be. And that's anything in life, you know what I mean? That's like the relatability that I was talking about. But that's like my goal with it, to kind of have that effect on people and allow them to look at it from a different point of view.
You wrote, once I connected to my purpose, I realized the desires were okay, but vision was the next level. The difference is that vision is greater than the individual. The vision is an all-inclusive thing that affects not only you, but those around you positively as well. Mm-hmm. Execution of the vision is where I make the biggest impact. I was here to inspire, to motivate, to be learned from, as I have learned from so many because of this game. So tell us more about this.
For me, it's pretty simple in the sense of, like, basketball is what I consider my purpose to be. It's, like, what I deeply love. But at the same time, it was just, I won't say selfish, but it was an individualistic way to just improve my own life, right? Like, play the game, I love the game. And in theory, it affects people around you, like my family, like everything like that. But at the same time, I think that being able to execute on the vision, like the grander scheme, that's where, like, the impact is longer lasting. So, you know, and the vision for everybody's different. For me, you know, I was really blessed with to be able to have sickle cell and be able to make an impact in that space. You know what I mean? So, like, and that's way more important than basketball, just because it has the ability to continuously affect people in a positive way for, you know, for a long, long time. So that's kind of where that, not even kind of, that does, it is where that came from. Desires. Nothing's wrong with them. Like, you need them, you know, especially in the world of form where, like, you know, we're goal-oriented people. But vision kind of supersedes all that in that it affects the collective. It affects the whole. You know what I mean? And then, like, in a grand scheme, the world's a better place because of it. You know what I mean? And I don't know if I have that effect. If I don't have that effect, it's just, like, I'm sharing the story with that on my heart, like, with that intention. You know what I mean? And that's kind of the start of where you execute on the vision for me and where I execute on the vision, because it allows me to impact way beyond when I'm here. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Are there any stereotypes associated with sickle cell?
Yeah. Sickle cell kind of has a stigma around it. Where it started, I don't really know. A lot of times, and I've been in situations like this where when you have sickle cell, you can't really treat it with a ton of things other than, like, IV fluids, pain medicine. And the cro- a pain crisis can be extremely painful to the point where you need very strong, like pain meds, like morphine, things like that, to kind of knock the edge off. So a lot of times sickle cell patients can be labeled as like drug seekers because those are addictive medications, right? And even if they don't have an addiction to the medications, they can kind of have that label on them. So like you'll go into an ER, like, I mean, I'm having a crazy sickle cell crisis right now. And you won't say it that calmly, like you'll be in extreme pain. But like you go in and a doctor look at you and they'll give you a little something, like they give you like Motrin or Tylenol or something like that to kind of just, all right, here you go, like going about your way. And that's just something that's, especially places that don't see a lot of sickle cell patients, people that have sickle cell can run into those issues. That's like the major stereotype around it. I've been in a situation like that. That kind of went the opposite way. I talk about it in the book, but I won't like give the entire details here. But long story short, went to a hospital, was on the road during a game, had a crisis, went in there, thought I was a drug seeker, was tired of hearing my mouth. They just gave me like something that was way stronger than what I was supposed to have, and then it led to like a lot more serious situation. And that stories in the book, but that's kind of something that sickle cell patients deal with from time to time. It's unfortunate, but you know, just it is what it is. So the more sickle cell awareness we can get out there, the less people that have to deal with it. Mm-hmm.
And you know, you played all over the world. Tell us about your experience in Russia and how it was playing there with sickle cell.
Yeah, so didn't even get to the point where I was able to get on the court. This is a few years back in my career. Went to Russia to play one of the top leagues in the world out there. Great teams, great players. I was excited to go out there and play. I'd never been to that side of the world before. So, you know, some things that can make crisis worse or create them from the jump is like high altitude. Anything that like contributes to lower oxygen levels. So you're flying on planes, things that dehydrate you, playing sports, like playing like hot gyms, extreme heat, stuff like that, that can kind of send you into a crisis, right? So I was on a plane to Russia about 17 hours, got to Moscow, then went to Krasnoyarsk, which is like a part of Russia that I was playing in, another 5 hours from Moscow, so a lot of flying, a lot of planes. Got to where I was going, and then like a couple hours later, I touched down. They're like, "Yo, we need you to do some blow work." So I'm like, "All right." In my head, I'm like, "Man, I know these numbers about to. I know my oxygen levels, my hemoglobin levels are about to look crazy." You know what I'm saying? So go in, do it. Day later, I get a call. They're like, "Yo, are you okay? Like, how you feel?" I'm like, "I'm straight. Like, what's up?" Mm-hmm. They're like, "Yeah, your oxygen levels, your hemoglobin levels, like measures your oxygen in your body." They're like, "Yeah, they're extremely low." And that's just natural for somebody that has sickle cell disease. And out there, when I tried to explain to them that I had sickle cell, it was the first issue I ran into as a pro, because usually like the doctors and the medical staffs where I was going, they're like, "All right, you've played this long without any issues, you're probably fine." They're a little bit more strict in passing people on the physicals. So sent it to like the government, and the government was like, "Nah, bro." Like, and they don't see much sickle cell out there because it primarily affects people of color, people in like Mediterranean climates. You know, I was up north, like really far north, and they don't see one a lot of people of color out there. Just, you know, call it what it is. And then on top of that, a lot of people with sickle cell. So that was a situation where I was actually not able to play. Hurt me in the moment, but you know, it was just part of the game.
And was there ever a moment where you were having a crisis and you thought, "Man, I don't want to play anymore"? Has it ever gotten to that point?
Yeah. I'm going to be honest, it hasn't. It hasn't, nah. Because, like, I love the game of basketball so much to the point where, like, it's a how do we get it done approach as opposed to let me just try something else. Because it's just what I've been called to. You know what I mean? Like, I grew up in it. I love it with everything in me, like, so it's hard for me to not be in that space, you know what I'm saying? Like, it's hard for me to not do that, and eventually the game is, for sure, and I'll be in it in another capacity, but as a player, nah, and I attribute a lot of that to my parents, you know, like I was saying, didn't allow me to look at sickle cell with a glass half empty type of vantage point. They were like, all right, this is what you can do. Go out there, do what you can do. You know what I'm saying? And see like, well, how far you could take it. And we took it far. But I never looked at the game and said, nah, let me take it easy. I love it too much. You know what I'm saying? So like, it's always been a, what I gotta do next. Even when it was like at the lowest point, like from a health standpoint, it's like, all right, I'll bounce back. What I gotta do next again, no matter how long it take, what I gotta do next. Mm-hmm. And now we're here.
So any words of encouragement for young kids out there? There is a Billy out there going through the same thing who is looking up to you as their idol. Any words of encouragement?
If anything, I would just say you got, as simple as this is, you just gotta keep going. You gotta test your limits in the healthiest way possible. Like, specifically to a kid with sickle cell, look at it from a perspective of I can get it done, as opposed to doctors told me I can't do this. And the doctors are like, they're not against us by any stretch. Like, we need them to help us. But you know, test your own limits. Listen to your body. Understand that you're capable. That's what I want to get across with the book. Like, you're capable, for sure. Just kind of gotta do it a little bit differently. The fastest way to that is just persistence and a constant like belief, which is pretty cliche, but like it's cliche because it's true. You know what I mean? So that's all I would tell them. Don't take it too seriously, man. Like, just keep living, keep learning. What's up?
And there are so many great gems in this book. Mm-hmm. I gotta ask, where can we pick up Ode to the Warrior? Give us all the details.
All right, Ode is Amazon Books. It'll be on all my, we'll have links on everything that I post, everything I'm a part of. But run to Amazon Books, grab it. Be in bookstores in due time. But right now, if you wanna get it, it's out now. Go grab it. You go grab it. Everybody go grab it. Go get the book, man. But Amazon Books is where you can find it. Ode to the Warrior. Yeah, let's do it.
Never had a lot, this is all I need. People never care till it's RIP. Just turn their back on me for no good reason. Loyalty is priceless and it's all I need. Can't burn a bridge just to light my way.